Good evening.
Good evening.
Let's all stand and open up in prayer. Father God, we just thank you for these faithful worshipers that come tonight on a Wednesday night to hear your word and sing to you, Lord. And we just pray that you bless all of us and draw us into you and just have your way tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of our King rise among us. Let it rise. Let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the joy of our King rise among us. Let it rise.
With all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength.
with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength. I will serve the Lord with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength. With all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength, I will serve the Lord with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength. I will love you, Lord, with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, all my strength. I will love you, Lord, with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, and with all my strength. Feel free to take your seats, or you can stay standing if you'd like. When I walk by your side, I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. When that day comes, when I find myself standing in the sun, I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine. Only imagine, yeah, yeah. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Oh, in all of you be still. Will I stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah?
imagine. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you.
Awesome Lord we serve, huh?
And there's a peace I come to know, though my heart and flesh may fail. There's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. Shadows disappear, and my faith shall be mine. Jesus is overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. Victory is won, he is risen.
Praise the Lord. Would the ushers come forward, please, for tonight's offering? Father God, here we are, worshiping you, singing praises. And right now we're going to give to you, Lord, from abundance, because you give so freely to us and just take care of us. And we love you for that, Lord. We just give you in Jesus' name and thank you for everything.
To find you day after day, I wait for you. The deeper I go, the more I love your name. So keep my heart pure and my ways true as I follow you. Keep me humble. Your mercy, Lord. I cherish your word. I'll seek your presence. I'll chase after you with all I have. As one day I know I'll see you face to face. So keep my heart pure and my ways as I follow you. Keep me humble, I'll stay mindful of your mercy.
Lord, let's just have the ladies sing here.
Day after day, I search to find you. Day after day, I'm to deeper I go, more love your name.
Here you go, guys.
So keep my heart pure and my ways true as I follow you. Keep me humble, I'll stay mindful of your mercy.
Lord, ladies again.
Your word, seek your presence, chase after you with all I have. As one day I know I'll see you face to face. You'll keep my heart pure and my ways true as I follow.
Let's stand up.
Humble, I'll stay mindful of your mercy, Lord. Day after day, I'll search to find you.
Amen. Thank Amen. You guys very much. Awesome worship. Hey, church, it's now time for us to say howdy to somebody nearby, and it has to be howdy, can't be anything else.
All right. Hi.
Well, good evening again. You guys are sounding good as always, and it's good to have you here this Wednesday night. What a beautiful Wednesday night, except I had a few bugs fly into my face. Did anybody else? Some bugs tonight? Yeah, I know. They are flying around now, and we got them. They're back. But I'd say the weather sort of makes them worth it. Sort of. But we'll see how bad they get. Tonight, you know what, you guys, we are here, and I have, maybe I do have an announcement for you, okay? Looks like we've got this, the men's fishing trip. You guys, that's on Saturday the 14th. That's going to be Dogtown Lake. That's going to be something that you are going to have a great time at. We're going to be leaving the church at 8 o'clock in the morning, okay? So what I want to recommend you guys do is come to men's prayer, which is at 6:30 on Saturday morning. We're done about 7:30, and then you get prepared and you go. Okay, it'll be a good time of fellowship. That's this coming Saturday. And that is my only announcement tonight. So I'll tell you what, you guys, let's get into it, huh? We're in Ecclesiastes chapter 12. Ecclesiastes 12. And you will probably note by my title, we are talking about an ending here. It all ends simply. It all ends simply. Tonight we are finishing the book of Ecclesiastes. I know, it's true. Miracles do happen. Yeah, boy, that was quick. Okay, well then I'll tell you what. I'll just get right into this right now, a little review then of where we were the last time I taught. We actually went halfway into verse 1. You might remember that. We went halfway into verse 1 of chapter 12 because it connected from verse 11. It was sort of a bridge into Ecclesiastes chapter 12 where we spoke to the young. Solomon had written to the young folks. He had written to the next generation. That's the way I had labeled it for you, was Solomon's writing this. God's speaking to him. He needs to pass along wisdom. And he realizes that it is something crucial. He says, okay, I want you, the next generation, to know, those who are after me. He writes it up, and basically the summary was this. Hey, when you're young, live it up in the Lord. When you are young, do it now for God. God has chosen you, respond. Remember that? Like, take risks. We talked about taking risks. Take chances when you're young because you can. You pray about things and you speak to elders and pastors and people of wisdom. And you know what? You say, if this is what God wants me to do, bam, I'm going for it. Solomon's basically like this. That is what draws you to fulfillment, because you're not doing it for you. You're not doing it just to have a good old time. You will have a good old time, but actually this thing is about eternity, and this thing is about the Lord. So the end of chapter 11, geared to the youngsters, geared to live it up in God, geared to, it's not about what's here. What did he call that? He called that under the sun. It's not about what's under the sun. It's about purpose. It's about eternity. It's about fruit and rewards. Because that's it. You got to do it. So now in this final chapter, basically, here's what he's going to do. He's going to flip to the other side. He's going to say, what happens if you wait? What happens if you... Now listen, you guys, okay. Disclaimer. Solomon's going to be a little blunt about old people. Okay? This is not Raj being blunt about old people. So please, I'm going to use certain terms about, you know, the old folks and how they're all rickety and stuff like that. That's because it's Solomon's fault, not Raj's fault. So if you got a problem, take it up in heaven. He's the guy. But that's what he's going to be talking about. Is this. Hey, don't wait. There's going to come a time in your life where it's just going to be too late. Or there's going to come a time in your life where you're going to be as passionate as a 20-year-old, but you just don't have the ability like a 20-year-old. So that's this side of it, chapter 12. And then finally, you guys, the last few phrases, it's Solomon just putting it all in a nutshell, so to speak. Makes it so simple, but it should drive us. I want, you know what, when we walk out of here today, you guys, we got to be on fire. I already know most of you, and you guys are on fire for Christ. You know, turn it up. This is one of those places in the Bible where you finish this section, and hopefully the Holy Spirit has just lit that fire all the more to get you out there going for Christ, to get you out there serving the way he wants. Okay, this is just the coolest end. Chapter 12, I called it all ends simply, but man, it is rich. So let's pray, and then we'll look at the text of Ecclesiastes chapter 12. Lord God, we are thankful. Lord, you brought us here for this wonderful time of worshiping you together. Lord, of fellowship together. God, now to study your word. Lord, to be enriched. And Holy Spirit, that's what we pray for, please, that you would absolutely enrich every one of us. Lord, we are just as moist clay, and we pray, you, the potter, that you would shape us, that you would mold us. As you inspired Solomon to write these words, Lord, that they may just, oh, take root in our hearts. And God, that we do walk out of here all the more passionate for Jesus, all the more passionate to be children of the living God, producing fruit for your kingdom. And that is our prayer. We praise you. We thank you that you will answer that prayer. We love you and pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. So, let me say one thing prior to getting into chapter 12, and that's this, because some of you youngsters are in here tonight. The question came up, what do I do? Like, it was a very practical question to me. So what do I do? You said when chapter 11, go for it. Like, what does that actually mean, go for it? Am I supposed to go take off and go somewhere and blah, blah, blah? Let me give you an example, actually. God used yesterday. Yesterday, I was interviewed on the radio station. I think I told you this was going to happen on Arizona Shine. So I was able to sit down in their little recording studio, and some pastor was asking me some questions. One of the questions he asked was this: so how did you get to where you are? And I'm like thinking, by the way, that's kind of me paraphrasing, okay? If you hear it on the radio and he doesn't say that exactly, it's close. It's, Raj, so how did you get to where you are? Meaning being the senior pastor of Calvary Chapel of Prescott. The fact of the matter is, it was no plan. The fact of the matter is that I wasn't working on a path. I didn't have a project laid out, you know, where I went step one, two, three, so that ultimately it would be the podium here at Calvary Prescott. Basically, what I said was taking every step, stepping through every door as the Lord popped it open. And man, that's just where you go. And we talked about how, you know, I played the drums at Calvary Chapel of the Foothills over there, served in the children's ministry. Missy and I hosted a life group. You name it. Like, wherever there was an opening or an opportunity to serve God, we were in it. And inevitably what happened, I remember, was that Pastor Gary, who was the pastor over there, he started giving us sort of more responsibilities. It just unfolded that way. He gave us more opportunities, and we were just so excited about it. You guys, you got to stay, though, the course. Because there were times when Missy and I, we were exhausted. There were other things going on in life. You know, those other priorities creep in. You got to stay that course. And you step through one door at a time, and what happens? It grows. You know, it continues to grow. We got to a point where, you know, there was an offer to buy our business. And that was our livelihood over there. What do we do? Do we like sell it? And then what do? And we're prayerful and we're thoughtful and we're thinking maybe this is a God thing. So we go for it. And not but a few months later, Calvary Chapel of Prescott is hiring for certain positions that I happen to be perfectly qualified for. And we make the move. And it's the same thing. It just continues and it continues. I want that to inspire you. We have to be able to just look at the next step and not have to plan out the course of our lives right now. So an encouragement to especially the youngsters, but to all of us, get in it. God's got you here for a purpose. Stop turning away from open doors. Step through and watch what the Lord does next. So there you go. That was my little part for that as an answer to that question, but I want all of you to know it, okay? So verse 1, let's read it. I'm going to read it. You follow along. Remember also your Creator in the days of your youth. Here it comes. Before the evil days come and the years draw near of which you will say, I have no pleasure in them. Okay. Now, modern translations use the word evil. Older translations use the word difficult. But you understand it's referring to the years of being old. The years of being old are characterized as either being evil or difficult. I told you, this guy, he speaks it. So he's talking about that time when life just gets tough. It's tough. Last week, I was getting some lab work done. And in the lobby in that medical center, I saw a lady who used to come to this church. And the reason she and her husband don't come anymore is because of health issues. And she told me, in essence, this: Raj, don't you believe for a minute that these years are the golden years. Because there's nothing golden about these years at all. It's like there's 2,000 pounds of lead on my shoulders. These are the lead years, not the golden years. Stay young. I'm like, okay, all right, thank you. I and the other 20 people in the lobby heard you. Thanks for that advice. But there's Solomon. He goes, man, these are the lead years, not the golden years. In the next 5 verses, you know what he does? Here's what's really cool. If you've ever studied Ecclesiastes, let's say in a literature class, which I did back in college, they would call this one of the most eloquent poems regarding the older years in all of literature. Yeah, I know. It's like blah, blah, whatever. Uh-huh. Verses 2 through 5 are those verses. I want to go for it. Let's do it. Verse 2. Before the sun and the light and the moon and the stars are darkened and the clouds return after the rain. Okay. I'll just talk about his imagery, just straight up blunt. So in those later years, basically what he's saying is older people don't think. Older people think. Older people don't think as clearly as they once did. Their memory is not as sharp as it once was. Have you ever experienced an older person telling you the same story for the 28th time? Probably you have, because I have. I get to a point where I hear their stories and I'm correcting them on their stories. It's like, not a blue car, a red car. That's what you were driving when you went up the hill. You know, that's the way it comes. But Solomon says, yes, that's life. In verse 3, Solomon says this, in the days when the keepers of the house tremble. So he goes from the mental immediately to the physical. This is the poetic description of arms, by the way. In the days when the keepers of the house, that's this stuff right here. Now, you know what? Mine are seriously strong, like seriously strong. But there will come a day when they're just not as seriously strong as they are right now. Gosh, all right. You know, my arms are not seriously strong. I wanted to see if you were listening. Instead of being able to do what you got to do, you're going to be weaker. There's going to be the shakiness. Hands are not going to be as bold, not going to be as quick. Holding your coffee, it's going to be shaky when it comes up to your lips. That's just what Solomon says. He goes, the strong men are bent. That's an illustration of the legs. the legs get frail. You know, they say old age is when your knees buckle, but your belt won't. That's what that's about. Verse 3 continued, the grinders cease because they are few. Now, what are the grinders? Of course, those are your teeth. When they start falling out, particularly now, grinders refer to your molars, the stuff in the back, like when you chew, you know? And you got to get those fake teeth, and you bite into that corn on the cob, you put it on the table, and your teeth are with the corn on the cob, because that's the way it goes with those grinders. Solomon says, unfortunately, those will become too weak as well. Verse 3, continue. And those who look through the windows are dimmed. Hopefully that's an obvious one too. That's when the eyesight goes. Let's see, that's when there are reading glasses at every table, in every drawer, in every bedroom of the house. Yes, I know many of you know what I'm talking about. Men, you probably wear your wives' reading glasses often because you don't know where yours are. This is what Solomon speaks of here. But there's more. Verse 4. And the doors of the street are shut. What does that mean? Interesting one. Here's what I go for. The droopy upper lip, where your mouth sort of has a permanent sort of a shut look to it. When this thing comes over the truck, it says, and the doors of the street are shut. It just causes like a permanent closed mouth, so to speak. When the sound of the grinding is low. When you eat and you chew and it's not loud anymore. That's what he's saying. I mean, if you eat dinner at our house, we got four boys. Well, five with me. So chewing, you can hear it echoing through the hallways. But in this particular age, it doesn't happen. When you're old, you don't chew loud. Why? Because you mostly eat soup and yogurt. That's why. That's what you have to do when you're old like this. So, or the food you eat has to go through a blender first. So that's why the chewing isn't. I told you, this is all Solomon, not Raj. This is all Solomon. Verse 4, and one rises up at the sound of a bird. You know, this is about sleep. When I lived in L.A., I was in my early 20s. I slept through two earthquakes. I slept through two earthquakes. Didn't even, like, I had no issue with it at all. Woke up to the news and it said, you know, a 4.4 Kembler rocked the city. I'm like, dude, really? Oh, okay. When you're older, though, even the littlest noise, even a little bird chirping, and it wakes you up. That's kind of the way things go. You go to bed earlier, you wake up earlier, you're disturbed a little easier. And Solomon says this is what happens as time goes by. Verse 4, the daughters of song are brought low. That'd be this right here, the ears. It's where the hearing starts to go. It's where you look on the stereo and you know it goes from 1 to 10 and you're like, gosh, I wish there was an 11. Like, oh, it can only go up to 10, but that's where it is. So Solomon's talking all about how you don't have the ability when you get to this age to do what you could have done. And look, you know, all joking aside, it affects your ability to do ministry. The Holy Spirit wants God's people to know God has designed us to be stronger in the younger years. Use your strength in the younger years. He goes on, verse 5. They are afraid also of what is high. They're afraid also of high. They can easily fall. Remember the Life Alert commercial where she goes, help, I've fallen and I can't get up. And she hits that little button. Just for your info, you know on that website, Life Alert, they have 32,000 testimonies of people who were saved by their little Life Alert button, telling the authorities that they've fallen and they can't get up. 32,000 testimonies. This is what happens. Falling is a scary proposition for some older folks. It says, and terrors are on the way. Things can make you easily frightened. You know that you don't have the physical strength, perhaps, to ward off an attacker. Perhaps you don't have the ability to lift particular things or do whatever else. But that's a scary proposition. And so instead of trying it, you avoid it. He says, when the almond tree blossoms, that's just about the color white. When the almond tree blossoms, this is about your hair, well, it grows, and it grows white. Verse 5, the grasshopper drags itself along. So the imagery there is about, if you look at a grasshopper, the bug, its legs are really big, like disproportionately big. They're huge, and they're bent like this. If you didn't know what a grasshopper did, you would think that this is just a weird-looking bug, period. But when you see a grasshopper jump and being able to sort of fly, you go, wow. Like, whoa, now I get what the legs are for. But there comes a time when even that grasshopper can't use those legs anymore. And it goes back to just looking like a weird bug. And this is what Solomon says. We don't get to use what we got. And it kind of feels weird and looks weird. Verse 5, and desire fails. Remember Solomon, of course. He's the man who had a history with 1,000 women. And now he's probably pretty depressed. I mean, Viagra hadn't been invented yet. So he's like, you know, when desire fails, this is it. This is just the way it goes. Darn. In the original Hebrew, there's a darn at the end of that sentence right there. Verses 5 and 6, let's keep going. Because man is going to his eternal home, and the mourners go about the streets. Verse 6, before the silver cord is snapped, or the golden bowl is broken, or the pitcher is shattered at the fountain, or the wheel broken at the cistern. So here's what Solomon sort of ends this little section with. So things are kind of a bummer. Or a big bummer as you get older. And then here's the deal. Death comes. And death ain't a pretty thing. And the way he describes it, you're like, come on, man. What do you have to describe it like this for? It's real vivid. He's talking about, you know, like the neck being broken, the spinal cord being severed. He's talking about the brain and it getting injured. He's talking about heart attack, you know, aneurysm, whatever it is. He's speaking about stuff like that because older folks are more susceptible because their bodies are weaker. And boy, you can just tell. Remember, Solomon's old when he writes this. He's basically writing this about himself. You know, he's not smiling, going, hoo-hoo, you know, yeah, no desire for women, yahoo, and then all that stuff. He's going, you know what, this is me. And this is what is probably inevitably going to be happening to a guy like me. So verses 7 and 8 answer this question. Hey, Solomon, come on, man. Why did you have to be so blunt? Like, really, couldn't you have used easier stuff? Because we would have gotten it if you would have just said, when you're young, do lots, because when you're old, you can't do lots. That's not the way he says it. You know what I think it is? I think it's what you would call a serious, you guys, kick in the pants. It is meant to grab your attention. And the Holy Spirit doesn't want us to read words that he, look, these are the Holy Spirit's words, right? In fact, he's going to say this. Solomon's going to say in the end, these are God's words. When God poses to you and me, language like this, vivid, blunt, disturbing even, I think we really need to take note. It's different than him just putting, you know, some metaphor before us, some illustration, some parable. It's different. Because I think here in what Solomon has done, he has come to the conclusion. When did he give us the conclusion of the matter that all of life under the sun is vanity? Right at the beginning. Right at the beginning. Because I think where the Lord wants you and me to go is this. Let's stop Let's stop giving ourselves the reasons or the excuses. I think this is one of those books, you guys, where he wants us to feel convicted. He really wants us to receive his conviction. Now, of course, you know, conviction is a holy thing. It's not a condemning thing. And he wants us not just to know, but he wants us to respond. I think that's why Solomon put the part where my spinal cord could get severed. I think what he's saying is, if you just have the knowledge, you'll be okay just kind of sitting around. But if you really think, man, there's going to come that moment, and that moment might be right now, God's people are compelled to action. So the summary of all of that was, be compelled to action. That was it. Verse 7, and the dust returns to the earth as it was, and spirit returns to God who gave it. Because in the end, it's all a God thing. Because in the end, death doesn't stop. I mean, you don't stop at death. In the end, you go back to God. You started and you go back. He's the one who put you here for a reason. And whether you decide to live out that reason is your call. But you got to understand something. In the end, you will go back before him. You will stand before him to be judged. He's going to say that as well as he ends this section. Sad thing, though, of course, you guys, is this. You don't have to be old to die. We don't know when death will come. And this is one of those things why we're supposed to be compelled to live it up no matter what our age is. Because this is going to come to all people at one time or another. My spirit's going to stand before God. What is that going to be like? I'm going to die. I'm going to leave this earth one day. I don't know when. Who knows? All I know with certainty is I'll be standing before my God. Like, wow. Again, he's going to even deal with that in just a minute. But see, if these kinds of thoughts go through our minds, what did I say all of this was about? Compelling us to act. Verse 1, please look at it again. Remember your Creator. The key word that I underline, by the way, is the word remember, okay? Remember. Solomon just won't let you go. He says in the end, it's all about the Creator. In the end, it's always going to be about God. In the end, he's the one that you're going to go see. Remember your Creator. Consider the centrality of God in your heart. Is that how you live life? Is God the center? I saw a guy, he drew a picture of a heart. And he drew, you know, like in this heart, a cross. And it was supposed to be like a cross-shaped hole. And then he drew these, basically what the world would call substitute crosses. And they were really close, you know, like money. It would just be like that much off of the cross. And you would think that if you picked it up, you could actually put it right there. Well, in this case, it was a drawing. But you would be able to just stuff it right there and it would fit the hole. But of course it wouldn't. And that would be relationship. You know, finding the man, finding the woman. And, oh, man, it's so close. No, it didn't work. And then it might be knowledge. Remember, Solomon comes up with knowledge as well. It might be what? Partying. Think of all the things that Solomon came up with. And they were close to cross-shaped. And what Solomon says right here is this. It doesn't matter how close the shape is. None of them will fit. Only the cross will fit. And once you've got that hole plugged, and I don't like that word, once that becomes the center of your heart, then, okay, money's not bad. Because you know what you're going to do? You're going to use the money for him. Relationship, that's great. You're going to make sure that your marriage is something that models the church to Christ and his relationship. How cool is that? You're going to say knowledge. Well, I'm going to do knowledge because maybe I'll be able to teach the Bible one day and I'm going to make sure the gospel message goes out and people hear, you know, the word and get fed. That's cool. But the idea of Solomon is, remember, there's a cross-shaped hole, and only Christ fits that hole. Solomon says, remember your Creator. He's the only one who fits that. So I think I think that's a good summary for verses 1-8 right there. Get acting. Act. Be compelled. Take it seriously. Remember that God has to be the center because it's all coming back to Him anyway. And would you do it already? Like, don't wait. Like, get it done. Get into it. Don't make any excuses. And guess what? You'll stand before God one day and you'll get a thumbs up. All right, so that's kind of me summarizing verses 1-8. Now where does he go? This is it. Final section. Chapter 12. Why I love this particular part, and this is what you would read through commentators and whatnot, is finally Solomon's just plain. Like, he just says, here's the deal. You don't have to, like, be a theologian. You don't have to study books. He just kind of says, God's granted me wisdom because he's let me go through the school of hard knocks. And I just want to tell you straight up. Here's what you need to do. This is this final section of Scripture, the final few verses of Ecclesiastes 12, verses 9 and 10. Let me read them. Besides being wise, the preacher also taught the people knowledge, weighing and studying and arranging many proverbs with great care. The preacher sought to find words of delight, and uprightly he wrote words of truth. This is his explanation for why I spoke in metaphor, why I spoke poetically, why I gave you imagery rather than just the black and white, here's the bottom line deal. Actually, that's really cool. Besides being wise, the preacher also taught the people knowledge, weighing and studying and arranging many proverbs with care. You know what Solomon's saying? Man, I took this so seriously. Like this mattered to me. What you see in this writing is Solomon saying this. This was my life's purpose. Nothing competed with this. You are so important to me that I prayed, that I was careful, that I wrote as necessary in order to really captivate you and capture your heart. That's the richness of verses 9 and 10. Besides being wise, the preacher also taught the people knowledge, weighing and studying and arranging many proverbs with great care. The preacher sought to find words of delight, and uprightly, he wrote words of truth. It's actually a pretty impressive little summation of why he wrote the way he did and what his heart was like. You guys, I want you to consider something here. Solomon went through a heck of a life. He made some pretty bad choices. Man, his dad, David, was a man after God's own heart. How come he didn't just follow Dad? What an opportunity he had to be a servant. What an opportunity, huh? To learn this wisdom. Dad, tell me more. You know, Dad, what did you do? Oh, Dad, you were in that kind of sin? Well, what did you do? And David would get to tell him, well, here's what I did, son. And on that interaction would go. You know what Solomon said? Forget you. Solomon said, I'm going to pick my way. God, get on the highway. Said, I'm going to go for money and women and partying and knowledge and, you know, possessions and all that other stuff. What I want you guys to see here in verses 9 and 10 is that can be us. I'll explain that further. Some of you have made some bad choices. I have made bad choices. There were times when we could have emerged from something with righteousness. And don't you just... Are you thinking of something you did or something you said where you had a choice to go the righteous way, but you decided you were going to say it anyway? Or you decided that you were going to do it anyway? Or maybe you kept on doing it. Maybe it even got to the point where it started destroying your life. I want you to consider, please, this: God uses us through those circumstances and situations. That, you know, somebody once came to me and confessed a horrible sin. And he was telling me about this. This was a couple of years ago. He was telling me about this sin and how he can't believe that he actually did it. It was the worst thing he could have ever done, destroyed his family and all this other stuff. And that's it for me. And what I told him back was, hey, dude, listen, you are repentant. Like, you want to live the life for Christ. He's like, yeah. He had tears. He's like, yeah, that's all I want to do. I said, well, then God's going to use you for something great. Do you understand how great your potential is? And he was the skeptic. You know, he was just kicking himself. He's like, dude, Raj, do you know who I am? You know the kind of stuff I did? You know how I just blew away the hearts of my children and my wife? You know how I just destroyed their lives? And he kept on saying that. And I said, hey, man, who's the God in heaven that you serve? Is he a God of grace? Or is he a God who condemns? And lo and behold, as the time went by, you know what God did? Put other men in his position, in his path. That he would come along, these other men who happened to do the very things that he did. And what he was able to say was this: let me tell you what God did for me. Let me tell you what God did through me. Let me tell you what the fruit that God produced in me was. And in essence, what happened was the Holy Spirit gave him words to speak carefully. He could weigh the words he spoke. He was able to speak in a particular order and in a particular way. And for the man of particular intellect, he was able to speak on his level. And I think that's what Solomon is saying right here. I sinned, I blew it. But what God allowed me to do was get used for his glory, and I get to do it in the way that ministers to you. Just like this guy got to say, hey, it's not a coincidence that you came into my path, because the Lord gave me words to speak to you. So, where have you been in your past? What foolish choices have we made? What kinds of things were you not even, you wouldn't dare tell any of us? But you've repented. But you definitely want the Lord, you know, to work in you and through you. Here's my challenge to you. How about if you just pray straight up? Lord, bring somebody into my path who sinned like I did. Lord, bring somebody, anybody. Give me an opportunity to be able to minister with power, with the knowledge, with the equipping that you would need, that he would need, in order to turn to you. Would you pray that sometime? We all have a unique story, and God can use all of us for his glory. That's the beauty, I think, of verses 9 and 10 right here. So, continuing then onward, shall we? Verses 9 and 10, how cool, just the Holy Spirit crafting all of that. Verse 11, the words of the wise are like goads, and like nails firmly fixed are the collected sayings. They are given by one shepherd. Stop there. Notice the word shepherd is a capital S, huh? At least it is in my Bible. I hope it is in yours. The capital S for shepherd means God, means the Lord. David wrote in Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd. What does that mean here? I think what he's saying is what I already told you. He's saying my words are in line with God's words. In other words, I am being used of God to speak these words. Our words are in conformity. You guys, this is how the Bible was written. God used men in their own positions, in their own places, with their own personalities, but he always made sure that their words, lined up with his. That is to say, the Holy Spirit was the author and Solomon was the pen. And this is what he's saying right there. My words. These are God's words. They've come together. These are God's words, and they're here in order to lead you to get going. Now notice that he compares God's words, okay, to goads. He compares them to firmly fixed nails. Those are great visuals. Really great. They would have totally gotten it, okay? You and I, a couple, few thousand years later, maybe not as much. But for those guys, yes. What's a goad? A goad is like a pointy stick. And let's say your cow was walking along with you and decided to stop in the middle of the road. And you're like, come on, cow, like, get going here. And the cow didn't. You take the stick, you know, this goad, and you could use it as a verb. You would goad the cow. You would goad this cow, you know, and the cow would be like, you know, moo, you're hurting me, and then the cow would move. And it's not like the goad is, the outcome is not to hurt the animal, but pain was necessary to move the animal. This is what Solomon is saying by using the illustration of the goad. And I'll give you two circumstances biblically, Christians, where we are goaded by the Holy Spirit. Number one, of course, we are goaded when we are stopped in sin. I hope that one was obvious. We are goaded when we choose the way of sin. And what the Holy Spirit does is he prods us, goads us, so that we will turn away from it, what the Bible calls repentance, turning away from that sin, and turning towards him and his ways. Now, if you want to take it further, sometimes there really is pain in your life. And sometimes that is a part of the goading process because you are in sin. Sometimes, you know, I am in sin and maybe there's actual pain that I'm experiencing. And I have to be able to go before the Lord, you know, and say, Lord, here am I. You know, Lord, look into the deepest recesses of my heart. Lord, show me what might be sin and I'll turn from it. And I have to do that again and again and again. I have a pastor friend who told me, actually a man that I met at one of the pastor's conferences. He told me, now he wasn't fanatical, he wasn't weird or anything like that, but he said something along the lines of, when I am in pain physically or emotionally, I am on my knees just asking God to cleanse me. That's like his number one prayer. Before he prays for healing, he prays for cleansing. The first thing he does, he repents. Even if he can't think about any specific sin, he goes like this, Holy Spirit, I am open. Please, please reveal the sin. Cleanse me of it. I shall turn from it. He always made sure to deal with the spiritual aspect before he dealt with any other. And that was pretty compelling. It's very compelling. Nevertheless, like I said, he wasn't fanatical. It wasn't weird. I got it. He just wants to glorify Jesus. And if there's any part in his life where he felt like he wasn't, he said, God, please let me glorify you here. So we're goaded when we're in these sins. What else? Second one would be something Peter would say. And that is that you are allowed to go through trials. Now, if you want to talk about the goading, the pain, then you would talk about the trials of life. But these trials of life, are they to, you know, turn you from sin? No. They're to strengthen you in the Lord. They're to cause you and to cause me to become more like Jesus. They're to cause us to be able to bring glory and honor to Jesus. How? By you and I, you guys, in the midst of the trial, we don't give in, do we? We don't give in to it. We allow God to use us in it. This is the part of the proper response to that goading. Let yourself in. If God wants to take you through a trial, okay, Peter said, hey, you know what? Trials show the genuineness of your faith. He said, keep that strong so that when Jesus is revealed, there will be honor and glory and praise before the whole world. Can you even imagine? You're going through a trial. Look at it with the big picture Look at it through the big picture. You might be going through this trial. Can you imagine that you are being used so that the world will glorify Christ? That's what he says of us. You're going through a trial. Look at it from that perspective. If you look at it from the older perspective, meaning Solomon and under the sun, forget it. But when you do it this way, you say, okay, God, the goading hurts. Trial hurts. But here I am. Use me. So that's the part of the goading. Very powerful image. What's the other one? Firmly fixed nail, right? The firmly fixed nail. Now, they didn't have the coat racks back then. They had the nails that they were stuck into the wall, and that's where they would hang their things from. And this is essentially what Solomon is saying. You hang your life on the Word of God. This is it. This is your firmly fixed nail. The Word. Remember what he said? My words are in line with God's. And then he says this, firmly fixed nail. Psalm 1 says that the one who consumes God's words is planted deep by streams of water. I just love that. Love that imagery. When life's trials come, and they will come, what do they say? There are two kinds of Christians, one that is either in a trial or one that's about to be in a trial. Those are the only two options? Yeah. When you're in that trial, here's the deal. You got to hang on the Word. That's your solution to the issue. That's the way you deal with whatever the goading, whatever the trial, whatever the repenting is, you have to go to God's Word. This is the nail firmly fixed. Oh, yeah, you'll bend, but you won't break. When that's what you're hanging on, there'll be the trials. You know what? Jobs get lost. Close family members get lost. Hard times come. Money is tight. There are emotional struggles, all of those things. You guys, the bottom line here, the Holy Spirit says is, here's what will firmly fix you in that. My Word. This is the ultimate answer, basically, to everything for us is God's Word. You use it. How about if I just put a period there? You use it. I love how it says firmly fixed. I want to tell you something. See where it says firmly fixed? Well driven. Some of your Bibles might say well driven. In the Old Testament, one of the names for Jesus is the peg of the tribe of Judah. The firmly fixed nail of the tribe of Judah. So in essence, what Solomon is saying is what we know. You hang your life on the Word. That is to say, you hang your life on Jesus Christ. And that's what gets you through. That's what gets you to, and that's what gets you out. And all things in between. How are you doing with hanging on Christ? What does your coworker see? Is he a man or a woman who just kind of naturally goes, you know, Lord, and this is genuine, Lord, what now? Not, Lord, what now? Lord, what now? Husbands, hey, do our wives see us do that? Do our wives see us in the peg of the tribe of Judah, hanging on to him, taking his word, saying, show me? Is that what people are seeing whom God is putting into your life? Or do you call something else what you hang on to? What is it in your life? What brings you security in your life? And what I want to compel you to is this. The answer must be Christ Jesus and his word. If something is competing for it, go before God. Lord, you know, break me. Remember what we talked about. Lord, I repent. I want to turn. And make sure that this is where you go, because Solomon said that's where you need to go. How cool. Let me read real quickly a paragraph I wrote here. Christians, we can confidently put our lives on Christ Jesus, knowing that we will never fall, we will never flounder, but we will eternally flourish. I always think of Romans 8. Nothing will separate us from the love of Christ. Not trouble, hardship, persecution, famine, nakedness, danger, sword, nothing. That is the peg of the tribe of Judah. He goes on, verse 12. My son, beware of anything beyond these. Of making many books there is no end, and much study is a weariness of the flesh. We got some students in here. This is not God's permission to not do homework, okay? Don't even go there. Yeah, Dad, God said I don't have to study. That's not what God is saying here. What Solomon's saying is this. When it comes to being goaded, when it comes to living life, when it comes to being fruitful, your instructions come from one place and one place only, God's word. Don't even go anywhere else. Right? What do they say? I saw a statistic that said every day nearly 3,000 new books are published. That is insanity. I had no idea that it was that much. And you've got books that talk about the how-to, what's best, how to flourish, how to handle an issue, what is coming, even, you know, being eternally secure, blah, 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 that stuff. That's dangerous. Talk about competition, Christian. We must stand firm on the word, huh? We got to show this off too, because if our world is getting more than 1 million books a year, inevitably you are going to run into somebody who's going to say, my book is as good as yours. And you're going to be holding up a Bible. You need to be able to say, no, it's not. It's not, and let me tell you why. Let me show you why. Let me be a demonstration of why. Guys, the word is the one thing that we stand on. It is the one thing that feeds us, drives us, motivates us, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, we accomplish it. Let nothing compete with the word of God. Verse 13. And with that, we come to Solomon's ultimate conclusion. The end of the matter, all has been heard. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty. That's the key. For this is the whole duty of man. Okay, let's see here. Hold on. The end of the matter, all has been heard. Here it is. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. So we just went through nearly 12 chapters to come to this sentence. The end of the matter, all has been heard. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. We know life is not under the sun, so we can sweep that away. We understand it's about God, and so here's your purpose, oh dearly beloved of God. Fear God and keep his commandments. That is the whole duty, the bottom line. You want satisfaction? Fear God and keep his commandments. You want meaning to life? Fear God and keep his commandments. You want the bottom line to life? Fear God and keep his commandments, says Solomon. Wow. It's all the God thing. Guys, I hope that's really like obvious for the pastor to say to the church. It's all a God thing. It's all about God. You know, amen, hallelujah. Yeah, it's all about God. C.S. Lewis used an interesting illustration. I'll just give you the real quick rundown. Basically this, that God made the human engine to run on himself. You know how there's some engines that'll say like, you know, unleaded only, diesel. God made the human engine to run on himself. And this is what Solomon says in a nutshell. We run on him, and here's what that looks like. Fearing him, obeying him. That's it. You want to run on God? You fear him? You obey him. You're here for him. The engine that's in your car, it's there for your car. We're here for God. Colossians 1:16. For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. What does this last part say? All things were created through him and for him. Yeah, engines, we run on God. That's why we're here. I'm here for him, you're here for him, we're all here for him. 2 Corinthians, let me just read you a couple of references here. 2 Corinthians 5:9, Ephesians 5:10. They both say that we're created to please him. How does your life do? Real simply, that's what the words say. You were created to please the God of heaven. That's mighty food for thought, huh? Dude, what I did an hour ago, did that please Jesus? Like the way I talked to my sister yesterday, did that please Jesus? When my boss disrespected me, did the way I responded please Jesus? Was my decision to spend my money here rather than there, did that please Jesus? 2 Corinthians 5:9 and Ephesians 5:10. That's my purpose, to please Jesus. Fearing God, was asked this last week. What does fearing God mean? What is it to fear God? You know what? That's kind of a hard one. To be honest with you, I can't really say fear God is this in a nutshell. It's one of those areas of scripture that I can teach because it is something we're told to do, but to tell you, okay, so here's what step one looks like and step two and step three, and that's the path to fearing God, it doesn't quite work out that way. Yeah, John Bunyan, right? Pilgrim's Progress, John Bunyan. He said to him, the best description of fearing God was called holy dread. Holy dread. Like there is a bit of a fear factor to it, but it's holy fear. So it's not like you're going to be condemned and struck down by a bolt of lightning, but you know you sure deserve it. You know that he sure can, and man, it would be nothing to him. You know that he is the creator. I am the created. You just know how grand and amazing he is. And so you say, okay, God, I shall make sure that my life is all about fearing you. There's a story in the Bible where the disciples, this is Luke chapter 12, the disciples are sitting there going, oh, woe is us. They're going, oh, these people. They're kind of like dwelling on, what do the people think of us? What can the people do to us? Right? It's something we all think. We think about people and we think, you know, what is their influence? How might they think of us? What's their perception of me? What might they do? So the disciples are sitting there. This is Luke chapter 12, like I said. And Jesus comes up to them, or Jesus is with them, and he says this. He goes, boys, don't be afraid of them. All they can do is kill you. That's all. I'm sure they're like, okay, great. All they can do is kill us. But he goes, all they can do is kill you. Don't you fear them. He goes, here's what you need to do. You need to fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Because don't fear the ones who can kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. What Jesus was telling the men is your attention should always be Godward, not manward. The idea of what the other person thinks of me better be trumped by what God thinks of me. How that person might influence me, I better scoot that one aside and say, how can I influence him for the Lord? If you do this big 180. That's essentially where Solomon is telling us here. You want to be living for God? Then learn what fearing him means. And that changes everything. You know, the command to fear God is put in the Bible almost 300 times, but the command to love him is in there about 80. To love God about 80 times, to fear him about 300 times. To trust him about 90 times. Why is fear God so way high up there. That's why I told you guys, there's not just kind of a step one, step two. Like, to fear God covers it all. That's why I think love God is less and trust God is less, because I think fear encompasses both. So the Holy Spirit wrote it in almost 300 times. The Bible says the fear of God is the beginning of wisdom, beginning of knowledge, the fountain of life, turns a person from the snares of death. Psalm 147:11, the Lord takes pleasure in those who fear him, in those who hope in his steadfast love. Well, what do you know? 300 commands to fear him, giving you 300 opportunities for him to take pleasure in you, says Psalm 147. That's pretty compelling. When I live a life that fears my God actually takes pleasure in me, little old me. This is why Solomon puts it in. I could speak fear God forever, so I'm gonna let that one go for now. Okay, final instruction: keep God's commandments. Let's get that done. Oh, by the way, statistics: 1 out of every 4 times that fear God is listed, a commandment is listed alongside of it. So fear God and keep his commandments. One commentator noted how when Christians do fear God, they want to obey his commandments. In other words, you'd expect me to say, the statistic of every time it says fear God to obey God is a one-to-one thing. It's built into you, huh? You ever had that excitement? I hope you do have that excitement where your life is all about doing what the Lord calls you to. You get up in the morning, you do your morning devos, and somewhere along the devos goes this prayer: God, show me what to do today, and I shall do it. God, show me what to do today. Empower me, because he will, and I shall do it. You're going to stand before this God, be in such awe. What happened when that happened? Somebody once said in the Bible, he said, here I am. You know, like, you're God, here I am, send me. Like, you're God and I'm me and you take pleasure in me, so what you want me to do is obey your commandments? Here I am, God, send me. And this is the kind of excitement that Christians are supposed to have as they live day to day. We get to see the face of our God and his word. We are empowered by our God in our hearts. And so we're supposed to be just like that and go, God, here I am, send me. I think many of you have something either on the horizon or a door is open to you right now. In fact, I'm the kind of guy who would venture to say 100% of us has a door open right now. There's always a door. And I want to challenge you tonight. I want to challenge you. If you have been avoiding it, stop. Step through. What does it mean? I don't know what it might mean for you. Some people, it could mean a job. Some people, it could mean something as simple as, not watching a particular show anymore. I don't know. But there's something God has put before you. And I'm telling you, through Solomon, through this book of Ecclesiastes, God is saying, boy, if you fear me, if you want me to be pleased in you, take the step. I think we should respond. This is where God wants us to be. It's our reasonable service. What did Paul say, Romans chapter 12? It is our reasonable service, considering who he is and what he has done for us. I like that. Romans 12 is a parallel to Solomon's words here in Ecclesiastes 12. So, again, my exhortation, please. Pray through it. Talk with your beloved if you have to. Gain wisdom for it. And get through it. This is what the Lord's calling us to. I have a final note that I want to read to you, okay? Solomon In telling the people to keep commandments, had 10 to go by. 10 commandments. As time went by, the Jews turned it into what? 600 and something? Little laws and regs and whatnot. And then Jesus comes along, and doesn't he summarize it all into just a couple? Like Luke chapter 10, verse 27. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind. And love your neighbor as yourself. The Holy Spirit just put that on my heart for all of us today. How about if we make sure that's a part of our prayers too, okay? If that encompasses it all, if that's your answer right there, it is worthy of prayer often. So please do in those final ones, okay? So now I'm on the final thought, which is verse 14. For God will bring every deed into judgment with every secret thing, whether good or evil. For me, I guess I come around you guys to the beginning, which was this. O child of God, take Ecclesiastes seriously. That's what I have on my notes. O child of God, take Ecclesiastes seriously. Time is going to come when we're standing before our God, right? O child of God, take Ecclesiastes seriously. God has doors open for you and he wants you to step through, right? Oh, take Ecclesiastes seriously. God has allowed you to get goaded. He's allowed you to go through the fire, even make some foolish choices that you're now out of. Take Ecclesiastes seriously. It's a time in our history, you guys, where we are watching the degradation of our society probably faster than, well, obviously in my lifetime. We are watching people who are okay saying, my God is as good as your God. I think more than any other time that I can remember. We're at a time where Christians are no longer on the offense, but they're on the defense. We're at a time where you are being persecuted in your society and in your culture more than has been persecuted that I know of in my knowledge of history. And so, what are you going to do about it? You're going to step up and take Ecclesiastes seriously, which I hope you do. You're going to look at it as opportunities to go for it in Christ, which I hope you do. You're going to make whatever changes it takes in order to please your God rather than to please men? I hope you do. And here's the wonderful promise of it all. God will be pleased in you, and God will use you for his glory and for his kingdom. Oh, I think that's good. Why don't we pray together? You guys, let me pray. Would you bow your heads, close your eyes? Lord, we're all just wonderfully blessed by the power of your word. Lord, by all of these principles that we've learned, or Holy Spirit, how you have strengthened us, convicted us, compelled us. Lord, it's been months and months of reading this imagery, Lord, of being told what it means to be your servant, what it means to turn away from sin, what it means to be dedicated to your purpose rather than any purpose of the world, to understand that life is about what's above the sun and not under it. Lord, we're so thankful. Oh, there's so much more. And now, Lord, as we walk from here, we pray, God, for that fire to be lit and even more to be raging. Holy Spirit, that you would absolutely, Lord, you would do a special work in all of our hearts. I pray for my brothers and sisters here. You have uniquely created each one of us for your purpose. I pray, Lord, please, that you would empower them to carry out that purpose. Lord, with boldness, there's a door open in front of all of us. May we, by prayer, by faith, step through. Or Lord, please give us the discernment to see a closed door and to turn away from it. We are so looking forward to how you desire to use us for your glory. Here we are, send us. We love you, Jesus. We pray this all by faith in your name. Jesus' name, amen. Hey, you guys, it's time to stand up now and close with a song of praise. If you need any kind of prayer, would you please find one of the leaders or turn to a brother or sister and pray with them? What I want to exhort you to again, Ecclesiastes is a book, please, to be keep reading, keep studying, let the Holy Spirit minister to you through it, okay? God bless you now. You have a wonderful night.
Something about that name, huh? Praise the Lord. Guys, drive careful. God bless you.